Hello and welcome to yet another brand new edition of Reset India, the show where we talk about what is being done and what needs to be done for different sectors contributing towards economic growth of our country. That is resetting and revamping towards a quick revival. I'm Tina Jack. In today's episode, we will be talking about one-person companies for which Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman made certain announcements in the Union Budget 2021-22. So what are the government measures with regard to the one-person companies and how these will benefit them is what we will be analysing on the program today with, of course, an eminent panel of experts. Let me introduce them to you. We are being joined on the program today by Mr. Mahendra Swaroop. He's Chairman, Startup Association of India. We have with us Dr. Omkar Rai, Director General, Software Technology Parks of India, and Mr. Rasik Pansari, Co-Founder and CMO, Get My Parking. Welcome, gentlemen, on this edition of Reset India on Rajya Sabha TV. But before we begin the discussion, let me, for the benefit of our viewers, play out some infographics. So what exactly is a one-person company? Now, of course, as the name suggests, a one-person company is a company that can be formed by just one person as a shareholder. And in order to bring in more unincorporated businesses into the organized corporate sector, the incorporation of one-person companies is being incentivized now by amending the company's incorporation rules. Besides, what is also being done is that the fast-track process for the mergers under the Companies Act of 2013 has now been extended to also include the startups with other startups as well as the smaller companies. Now, this will make the process of mergers and amalgamations faster. So also, with effect from the 1st of April this year, the rules governing the OPCs will see certain changes, one of them being permission to the non-resident Indians to incorporate OPCs in India. So previously, the NRIs were not allowed to incorporate OPCs in the country. Now, any natural person who is an Indian citizen, whether resident in India or otherwise, would be allowed to form an OPC. Besides, the government has also reduced the residency limit for Indian citizens to set up an OPC from the current 182 days to 120 days going forward. And this will come into effect from the 1st of April. Also, the finance minister has proposed in her budget speech to revise the definition under the Companies Act of 2013 for all small companies by increasing their thresholds for paid up capital to not exceed 2 crore rupees. She said the move is expected to benefit more than 2 lakh companies in easing their compliance requirements. So let me start the program today with Dr. Omkar Rai. Sir, let's begin the program with your views first on the removal of restrictions on paid up capital and turnover for the OPCs. How is it going to be beneficial for these companies?
In fact, it allows a lot of flexibility at and you can choose your timing to convert your one-person company into private limited company. And therefore, this flexibility sets you free from any worries. And therefore, you are totally free to do your entrepreneurial activity. In fact, this one-person company is a boon for the startups, young boys and girls. And it democratizes the formation of company access to the entrepreneurial opportunity, even for the young boys and girls from the smaller towns of this country.
Okay. Rasik Pansare, how is it going to help the startups, particularly with the provisions that have been announced by the finance minister?
In fact, it requires least compliance. It mortifies you from any personal liability. It gives you access to the capital. It gives trust in the investors in your company, and therefore it gives you all the benefits of a private limited company.
Yes, yes. Okay.
And it gives you all legal backing. And therefore, even if you are a one person with dream in your eyes and some ideas to convert into technology product or become an entrepreneur or a startup, this provision gives you legal backing. On the other hand, this also gives you totally very free nights. You can do anything you want because you are the owner of the company, so you are not worried.
Okay. Rasik Pansare, how is it going, from the point of view of startups, how is it going to help looking at the restrictions that have been taken off by the finance minister and several other provisions that have been proposed by her?
Surely, Kriti, it's actually, if you look at it, it gives a new option to entrepreneurs between forming a proprietorship and forming a private limited.
Mm-hmm.
So earlier, if you want to start a new startup, you always had to consider between these two options. And it's not really beneficial from raising investments and compliances point of view later on to scale up to form a proprietorship. So a lot of entrepreneurs, of course, go on and create a private limited company. Now, the problem with private limited company as an entrepreneur is that, first of all, you are not really sure if this will work or not. Actually, 90% of startups do fold up within the first 2 years of starting up. Now, closing a private limited company is a very big hassle in India. Also, the compliances and many other factors around it are also very daunting.
Mm-hmm.
So if you are a new entrepreneur setting out, an OPC, a one-person company, actually gives you a trimmed-down version of the private limited companies. At the same time, it allows you to convert into a private limited later on. So as a solo founder, it's really beneficial for you that you don't have to look for another director. A private limited company enforces you to have minimum two directors.
Yes.
As a solo entrepreneur, you don't have a co-founder, then you don't have any other director to bring on board. A lot of people find ways around it by getting their spouse or a parent or some friend as a director, as a silent partner. But that's just because the policies were not working for these solo entrepreneurs, rather than the solo entrepreneurs trying really hard to fit into existing policies.
And how is reducing compliance burden on these small companies going to be helpful in the longer run?
So reducing compliances just for the sake of it is not the point here. I think what is important is that understanding startups created and led by solo founders are of a different nature, and hence only certain compliances should be applied on them.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas a big private limited corporation is of a very different nature, and all those compliances can be pulling down a solo entrepreneur. So understanding that the nature of these two different ventures are very, very different, and hence the policies and compliances should be different. That intention, that realization is the first step.
Yes.
Which with the new policy, now it has become clear that the government recognizes. And hence all these amendments in one-person company will help solo entrepreneurs to comply with the law, which is suitable for them, while not really having the burden of unnecessary regulations and red tape, which are not really relevant to them.
Okay. Mr. Swaroop, let me now get you into the discussion and get your perspective on, allowing the NRIs now to incorporate the OPCs in India. Your perspective on this very move, and obviously in the longer run, the advantages as well as the disadvantages of allowing them.
I think first is that I must congratulate the finance minister for bringing such incentives for one-person companies, which are a boon for, as Rasik has already said, about solo founders. And this is also one step towards India becoming more easy to do business in.
Yes.
Now, coming to NRIs, I think it's a very welcome move, because many of these non-resident Indians who see India as a very big market but are living abroad hesitate to start companies here because of issues of formation of a company, compliance, and other restrictions. Now, with this incentive and reducing the time period from 180 to 120 days, will encourage many of these non-residents to form one-person companies here and bring in money from overseas, which they own money, to start these businesses. It's not only a boon for startups, as I think the intention of the finance minister is not only create an environment for successful startups, but also it's a boon for small businesses. So a lot of proprietorships, which are large businesses, now can convert themselves into one-person companies and have the advantage of not having the liabilities which a sole proprietor has. So if you have liabilities, then the sole proprietor's personal assets and everything are liable for action. Whereas if you form a one-person company, which is limited by liability, then your liabilities are restricted to the company assets itself. So it's not only a boon for startups, but I think it's a boon for all small entrepreneurs, right? So you could even have large retailers, traders, right? Merchants who are selling online, right? And on startups. So there's indirect benefit to the startup community as a whole, because a lot of merchants who are on online platforms can gain from forming one-person companies and also be able to attract capital and also debt. So most of the NBFCs and banks, right, hesitate to lend to individual sole proprietorship companies. But once you have a limited liability company as an OPC, then they can be receive debt, not only from NBFCs, but from also from nationalized banks and private banks. And equally from the new platforms, credit platforms, which are coming up to finance these new innovative ways of lending, right, all will benefit from one person company. So it's a great move on the part of the government to actually, as a step forward for ease of doing business in India.
Okay, Dr. Rai, coming back to you, since we're talking about NRIs, both our panelists suggest what's being proposed by the government is of course a welcome step, but going forward, is it going to be enough, merely allowing them to incorporate OPCs, or aided measures are required on part of the government to ensure ease of doing business for them?
I think there are two ways to look at it. I think
let me take that question to Dr. Rai.
Okay, fine, sorry. Yeah,
I'll come back to you, sir.
In fact, if you look at the government's resolve is to make sure that we continuously grow on the ease of doing business index. And that has been done in past also. This declaration or announcement of this OPC concept as a rule and law is one more, another step in this direction. What we are trying to do is that we have already launched Startup India campaign, and we are getting a lot of feedback and input from the startup community. And as and when these inputs are collated and a decision has to be made, it is made. This OPC is one such a bold initiative. In fact, if you refer about this NRI concept, that NRIs were actually not able to put their funding capital in Indian startup market because they were worried about the compliances that were required in terms of creation of private limited
company.
Now they can create this company and without even bothering about board meetings, about auditors getting rotated and all such things, they can involve themselves, indulge themselves in entrepreneurial promotional activity, in working with the startup community, are becoming themselves entrepreneurs and startup within India. And therefore, it's a big initiative. Nothing is enough at a point of time. Few more things may be required. But as and when the startup community or entrepreneurial community would raise wires, these things will be done by the government in times to come.
Okay. Mr. Swaroop, you wanted to add something on how a conducive environment can be created for these NRIs. It's a bold initiative that they have been allowed now into the sector, but going ahead, what is the kind of efforts on part of the government that will be required to make the environment for doing business more conducive?
I think one of the primary consideration for a non-resident to invest in India is that how easy is to take the money back, right? As Rasik said, that there's a very high rate of failure of startups, right? And also if capital is being brought in by the non-residents to start a business here, and then they attract further capital through venture capital and other ways, and whenever there is an exit which happens, then how easy is it for them to take the money out and be able to exit the one-person company?
Yes.
So I think once you form a one-person company, then you get regulated, and then there are several avenues available to you for exiting the business, not only exiting the business, but even taking your profits and your capital gains outside the country. Right? But if you are as an individual, if you want to invest in this country, then it's a different set of laws apply, which are very difficult to comply with, to be able to take the money out of, for non-residents especially. Right? So I think this will considerably improve the foreign exchange, or the FDI as they call it. FDI through NRIs will dramatically improve because of one person company concept. And the other thing is that the NRI may not have to look for any other director, because he can be the sole director and be the sole shareholder.
Yes.
So that's a very big advantage. One of the biggest disadvantages the private limited companies had was that there had to be another shareholder and another director. So then you are now in full control of your own destiny.
Right.
And your business. And that's a very big, big advantage for non-residents to put money back into India.
Absolutely. Okay, so now taking the discussion forward about some of the concerns that have also been raised on the new measures that have been proposed by the government. Rasik Pansare, let me come to you. There is an argument from experts that the new additions to the OPC structure do not benefit most of the founders who are looking to start up. Do you agree with this argument? And if yes, what exactly is the concern? Help our viewers understand.
So I don't agree with this concern completely. There is, of course, some segment of the startup ecosystem we should feel like that, because a lot of startups get founded by multiple co-founders. The solo co-founder as a solo starter is a very small percentage of all the co-founders out there. So the OPC, however, a very bold move and very beneficial for startup entrepreneurs, will only help those who are looking to do a solo venture, a solo founder venture. Mm-hmm. But when you are talking of other startups who are being founded by multiple directors, multiple co-founders, there's a lot more that can be done.
Dr. Rai, since we're talking about concerns raised by experts and investors, there is also a concern. In fact, investors have expressed apprehensions, saying that these relaxations may expedite the time that is required to incorporate an entity in India. Now, is that true? And if yes, how can the government allay these apprehensions?
In fact, this is contrary. People are saying that with these new declarations, the companies can be incorporated in very less time. These rules and provisions are going to be effective since April 2021. And the real benefit of these reforms are seen by the startup community and entrepreneurial community at large. And as I said, that these are bold reforms. And therefore, beforehand, having apprehensions won't be good. We are on the ground feeling that the startup community has taken it in a very, very right stride, and they are actually welcoming these decisions, and they are going to actually utilize this provision as far as the startup community is concerned. One very important thing we must note is that this, you can start with one person company, and anytime you can convert into a private limited company in case you get more partners on board. And therefore, it gives you enough flexibility to do whatever you want. And therefore, these apprehensions are actually beforehand, and we must wait for actually this to be tested by the real people on the ground.
Yes. Okay. Dr. Swaroop, let me also get in your views on any concerns, any potential problems that you see after the implementation of these change rules with the new additions and the relaxations to the OPCs?
I don't see many disadvantages of this new initiative which the government has taken. I think there are disadvantages when you get regulated in terms of compliance and costs. Right? So your cost of compliance will go up despite OP, one-person companies don't have to comply to as many regulations as like holding a AGM and having regular board meetings as any other private limited company or a publicly listed company has. So the costs of compliance for a one-person company will be much lower as compared to any other. So that's, the advantages definitely overweigh any disadvantage people are seeing, right? So I don't think so that the disadvantages people are looking into are actually non-existent. If you say that there is any disadvantage to this OPC, I think there is no. It's only an improvement over the existing structure of private limited companies and public companies. Mm-hmm. So I don't see any disadvantage in one bit. I think what it will do, right, is get a lot of sole proprietorships and smaller towns into the corporate network.
Yes.
And they'll be show a very clean path to growth for these entrepreneurs who are in tier 2 and tier 3 cities, who do not have access to resources to form private limited companies, have auditors, as Dr. Rai has said, have these compliance issues. So if you are in a tier two and tier three city, and you have to just go to the registrar and register yourself as a one-person company, and then you have access and benefits as if you were a private limited or a public limited company, right? So the so-called disadvantages actually overweigh any of these benefits which entrepreneurs and startup founders from smaller towns will get.
Okay.
I think this is a great initiative for founders from tier two and tier three cities to be able to actually compete at par with entrepreneurs in cities like Bangalore and Delhi and Bombay and Pune and Hyderabad, right?
Yes.
So it's a one big leveler. And the disadvantage which people had, right, for being in smaller towns in terms of this structure which they had to put together, right, is just taken away. So I will see a lot of new founders and lot of not only new startups coming up from smaller towns because of this ease of doing forming a company, but also that lot of venture capital funds will now flow into tier two and tier three city entrepreneurs because now they have a regulated structure to invest in. So I think it's a great move by the government of India. This will not only give a kickstart to the startup ecosystem in smaller towns, but also benefit lot of bright ideas which exist in the smaller towns, especially in agriculture, tech, logistics, right? And
yes.
Delivery of digital health. I think this is some of the key benefits which will flow into the greater social benefit of the people is going to be tremendous of one small initiative which people are seeing as one person company.
Yes.
I think one person company is a really big thrust to entrepreneurs from smaller towns and people with frugal means who do not have access to capital as entrepreneurs in tier one cities have.
Yes, yes. Rasik Pachauri,
this will also encourage venture capital fund managers to actually go into the interiors of the smaller towns to be able to identify bright young entrepreneurs with brilliant ideas.
Yes. Rasik Pansare, when we talk about trust to the entrepreneurial culture, we've seen quite a lot of efforts on part of this government. The Prime Minister keeps, talking about how there is a need to strengthen our ecosystem because they reflect our entrepreneurial aspirations of the country. So we've seen since 2014, there have been tremendous efforts, and because of which we have gone up higher in the rank of ease of doing business as well. We are currently at 63rd position. But obviously, there is a lot of scope to do much, much better. So talking from experience, what are the suggestions that you would give which will, in the times to come, strengthen the startup ecosystem in our country?
So definitely, the current government has boosted the overall startup ecosystem quite a lot. And all those policies were, they were waited for a long time. But at the same time, we should, have our sight on the future and look at what more can we do.
Yes.
How can we do ease of doing business even better? Suggestions would be to make it easier for investors, Indian as well as foreigners, to bring capital to Indian startups. Apart from that, also make it easy for exiting for investors after investing in Indian startups. So that would not only bring a lot of capital to India, it will also help the upcoming technology entrepreneurs to make sure that they register the company in India and not somewhere else. We have seen that trend recently, and we of course want to reverse that trend of Indian entrepreneurs registering their companies outside India. So that's something the government can look at. Other than that, we should look at how can we make all the compliances even more easier and digital so that the paperwork is completely eliminated and everything happens digitally. That's another aspiration. The third thing is how can we encourage the ecosystem and knowledge sharing from the heart of startup ecosystem, which is Bangalore and certain other metro cities, to tier two and tier three cities. How can we promote incubation centers, accelerators, provide seed funding? The new policy on the seed funding is also, of course, a welcome move. But how can we, spread that across the country and not just limited to metro cities? So there used to be a lot more to do, on the infrastructure building side of startup ecosystem, mm-hmm. And promoting innovation. But I think whatever we have is a good start, and it's a work towards the right path.
Absolutely. It is a good start, but it needs to be taken to the tier two and tier three cities, as both our panelists have suggested. One final comment from you, Dr. Rai, on what is the best way forward to further up our ranking in the ease of doing business report as well, and also to boost investment, which of course is vital to strengthen this sector.
Well, in fact, first part of the question is about how do we increase our ranking in the ease of doing business. So I already said in the past that this is a continuous process, and you just cannot predict or forecast or prescribe anything right now. It has to be from your experience and learning that you earn while you implementing certain policy, and the kind of input and feedback you receive from the targeted community. So in this case, the startup community, entrepreneurial community, and the young boys and girls of smaller towns would give this feedback to the government, personally at large, as to what is to be done further. And that would be definitely done. Secondly, that, as I said, this policy is very, very bold in that direction, that the young boys and girls of smaller towns can now create company without much hassle. They would not require the services of the chartered accountant, advocates, because once you create a company, you are not required to really comply with. This would be as good as registering an organization under Society Registration Act. So this is going to be very easy for the people. So once you decide to do something, you just form a one-person company, and then you forget about any compliance, because you are not required to, as Mr. Mahendra Swarup said, you are not required to actually conduct board meeting. You are not required to rotate your auditors. You are not required to create balance sheet, inclusive balance sheet, and
absolutely.
All those
things. You are in a way and simplifying the existing structure, and that of course is in itself is a bold initiative by the government to promote startup culture in the country, as has been pointed out by all our three panelists. But obviously there are some concerns that going forward the government has to allay. There are certain concerns raised by the investors and the experts which have to be taken into account. And also the government has to work towards strengthening the ecosystem, towards ease of doing business, as well as getting in more investment. So India has to be made investor friendly as well. So that's it from us on this edition of Reset India. Thank you for joining us on the program. Just in case you missed the broadcast, you can also watch it on YouTube. Thank you once again.